Hi, good morning. I expected to be with you in Germany today, so it's a bit of a disappointment, I'm sure, that we're all online. But hopefully today's conference is going to be interesting, talking about technology, video, education. And my role today is to talk about video and reflective practice. And so I've really thought I'll focus primarily on video, reflective practice, and teacher education. A lot of what I'm talking about is related to work that I've done with Steve Walsh, but the first project that I'll talk about is the VILTI project, Video in English Language Teacher Education, which was a British Council funded project. And I'm going to show you a range of video practices connected to teacher education that came out of that project. But I'll also be talking to you about the work that I've done with Steve Walsh on reflective practice, and this recent handbook, which is called the Routledge Handbook of English Language Teacher Education. That's got about 40 chapters, many of which are related to teacher education, reflective practice, use of technology, and video. And also this book here, Reflective Practice in Language Teaching, which is also an attempt to try and look at the importance of reflective practice for teacher education. So that's what I'm going to try to do today. So some of the key themes that I want to deal with today are, what are appropriate tools for reflective practice, particularly looking at video? I'm also going to be trying to talk about the importance of what we call dialogic reflective practice, and also I'm going to be looking at how video might be used in research. In the digital world that we live in, we're bombarded by images, by video. There's a lot of choice. And one of the downsides, I suppose, of the digital world is that we don't get time to reflect. So the question is, can we use some of that challenge for teachers, for whether they're pre-service or in-service, to slow things down a little? And I think Anna Witcher captures this really well in this short video. I'm only going to show you a little bit of it, but the link will be provided to you afterwards. So here's Anna talking about this challenge.
A visual manifesto for language teaching. Images. They create our world. They inhabit our space. They reflect what's in our mind's eye and are at the core of what we believe in, what we hope for, the beauty we see in others, in ourselves, the hope we find even in difficult moments. Images are an intimate part of our world, and they are everywhere. But how do we reflect on them now, with so many at once? Are they losing their impact? Do we really understand what we're seeing? Or is it lost in the bombardment? What do we need to do to make it stop?
So I think Anna captures that sense that we need to try and take control, to stop, to reflect, use video, to re-enter the moment, to think about the value, to think about our practices. One of the concepts that's been helpful to me in thinking about innovation and video is Kaizen, which is a Japanese term, word, idea, which means continuous improvement, small change, evolution, not revolution. And I think this is the key for how we as teacher educators or teachers use video. How can we take control and reflect on the process and the uses of video? So Kaizen means small changes, and teachers are in control of those changes. So let me tell you a little bit about the Video in Language Teacher Education research project. It was funded by the British Council, and it really had two aims. One was to map the existing uses of video in language teacher education, be it screen capture or post-observation conferences or portfolios, different platforms. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that later. We also wanted to get collaboration or contribution from a wide range of practitioners and showcase that work in a video environment, because it seemed a bit crazy to produce a written report about video when we could actually show different ways that teachers were using video. So I'll just show you around the site so that you can maybe come back and revisit it later. So essentially, if you go to the home page, you'll see a range of featured video practices. But there's also a tool at the top here, a search tool, where you can look for specific, for example, stimulated recall or flipped classroom, and see if there's any contributions. Each video has an accompanying PDF which explains the process. What did the actual teacher do? Which is kind of the Kaizen. How did they go about using video for that particular practice? So together, the video, which is introductory, and the PDF, which provides the links and detail, make a good resource if you're thinking about, for example, flipped classroom, thinking about stimulated recall, thinking about trying to do some more screen capture with your students. As I said earlier, a lot of the work that I've been doing connecting reflective practice with teacher education and video has been with Steve Walsh. And in our view of reflective practice, we were worried that it was often individual, often written. So we wanted to try and make it more collaborative, more data-led, more evidence-led. So here's Steve talking in an interview for the ELTJ about the importance of data and evidence.
So many of you as teachers and teacher educators will have had some involvement in doing reflection, in being reflective, as part of a training course, as part of a program that you've run perhaps. And the thing we're trying to say to you is, why bother with reflection once you've got a job, once you're actually out there teaching or involved in teacher education? We believe that there are ways of making reflection a key part of your job without imposing extra demands on your time and making your job even more demanding than it already is.
Another feature of our conceptualization of reflective practice is the idea of dialogic reflection. That's not just dialogue, it's a dialogic process that might happen between you and a future self, a past self, between something that happened in the classroom, between you and an artifact like a transcript or a video. So we're interested in that dialogic process. Here's me talking to Dirk about this idea.
My first question for you, Steve. Last week I spoke with Scott Thornbury,
yeah.
And we were talking about both the importance of not only just practice as teachers, but also the research and the relationship in between. Yeah. And we came to the conclusion that as teacher we should really try to look for collaborative practices between teachers in themselves. Now, I read an article that you published last year, which really fascinated me, which was the one, Collaborative and Dialogic Reflection in Second Language Teacher Education.
Yeah.
Now, my question for you is, what exactly, to start off with, what exactly is this collaborative and dialogic reflection? How do you interpret this?
Okay, well, in some ways it's quite simple, and in some ways it's quite complicated. So if we start with the simple idea, is that traditionally reflective practice has been seen as an individual and written pursuit, so that when people did reflective practice, or when it was talked about in teacher education, it was often as an individual diary entry, or someone kept a journal. So it was quite introspective and quite individual. So to move reflective practice into a more collaborative and dialogic conception or way of looking at it is to say that reflection can also be collaborative. It's something you can do with one or two or three other people, something that you can do with your learners maybe, and that those processes are interesting if they're dialogic. And by dialogic, I think it means both in conversation with other people, having a dialogue with other people, preferably with a peer, with somebody who's doing a similar job to you and similar interests, but also collaborative, dialogic in the sense that you might use some data, could be a recording of a class or some learner's work or a transcription or a bit of video, which helps that dialogic process. So dialogue doesn't mean just between people, it means between people and some kind of object or affordance or data.
Okay, let's have a look at a couple of examples. We're going to concentrate on pre-service teacher education first of all. In this first example, in Chetumal, Mexico, Alejandra is looking at her lesson. And I think we can notice the way that she's focusing on a particular moment, and the richness of the reflection is that it's tied to something very concrete. The data is fueling this very particular comment that she's making. It's in Spanish, so like me, you might not understand every word, but you'll see what I'm talking about.
Aquí, aquí ya me tuve que pasar al frente porque no encontré algo que encajara tal cual con la ropa de ella. Entonces, como quería una cambiar de color de cabello y otra que fuera una cosa con las que ellas estuvieran asociadas, la puse a ella. Entonces, cuando yo intenté pegarle la ropa y que cayera igual que en las anteriores, salía muy feo. Y dije, no, mejor no. Y dije, mejor lo que voy a hacer es encerrarlo en el pizarrón lo que quiero.
A number of the examples that we have on the Vilti website are teacher educators working with pre-service teachers. And what I think they need is a framework or a set of tools which work for them. And in this next video, we've got Laura Backer from New York talking about some of the steps that the students have to go through. And this is important to us in the Vilti site, is trying to make transparent what you actually do with the teachers, that step-by-step sense of what helps.
Colleagues, one protocol that we use, that we've experimented with in getting teachers together to look at their video, is to start with the teacher before they even come in to share video, is to think carefully about what teaching practice they wish to capture in their classroom and intentionally video whole class lessons. After they have footage from a whole class lesson, we ask them to review that and select an excerpt of a video clip, no more than about 7 minutes, because more than that is really too much to watch and it makes it difficult to rewind and replay when the video is longer than that. The next step is to ask the teacher to sit down and analyze the clip on their own in light of a set of target questions like the ones I showed earlier that get them to really hone in on a specific practice using timestamps so that they record moments of their video that they want to share before they come in. Then they do come together to watch their video clips in pairs or small groups sitting at a shared computer using an audio splitter so that multiple groups can be listening and discussing simultaneously in the classroom. The next step involves the teachers during the session taking turns following a really strict protocol so that the teacher showing their clip doesn't sort of avoid showing it and they get right into the viewing and the viewers know exactly what they're supposed to be looking for in order to help the teacher who is sharing the clip. Afterwards, it's an important step for the teachers to go back and to think about some of the viewing gains that they achieved by sharing and discussing the video with their partner teachers.
And also, in terms of in-service education, perhaps an MA, it's also important to look at how video can be used in creative ways to maybe get away from the idea that everything has to be an assignment, everything has to be in print. So let's have a look at an example of a teacher being creative about the use of video in looking at aspects of her identity. She then goes on to work with primary school students in making and helping them to make their own video. This is in Spain, in Valladolid. So at the University of Warwick, we try to integrate video and screen capture into some of the assignments that students work on. And one of the projects that Joe Gokonga leads is a mentoring project where more experienced teachers mentor a less experienced teacher, and they do some teaching practice. And there's a mentoring session. And as part of the assessment of that course, we ask them to produce a short video, a screen capture, which helps them to focus their ideas for the assignment. So let's have a look at Ivy talking about her realizations of whether she does it in L1, Mandarin, or in L2 in English.
Hi, this is Ivy. Welcome to my video. In this video, I will talk about my role as a mentor. Even if you know a lot about mentoring, you may find something interesting here. So, as mentors, we are experienced English teachers to provide developmental feedback to our inexperienced English teachers or mentees. Take me as an example. I was assigned with 4 mentees, and we are all Chinese. This was not a problem for me until we did our first mentoring. I was struggle whether to talk to them in English or in Chinese. To understand the situation better, we have 2 hours of mentoring, so 40 minutes to watch the first pair teaching, another 40 minutes for the second pair, and 10 minutes for the transition time. So only 30 minutes left for actual mentoring, which I actually did in English. But I extend over extra 30 minutes to do mentoring in Chinese.
So that's in the West, if you like, but what about video in more challenging contexts? This quote from Locke and a team in the Netherlands captures the challenge, I think. And so one of the challenges is, can we take some of this technology with all the constraints and barriers into more challenging contexts? And I've just completed a project with the British Council in Thailand where we used Iris Connect, the platform which is very similar to VO, although I'm sure Paul Seedhouse would say they're very different, but essentially they are a vehicle, a tool, enabling teachers to look at their practice. And we used Iris Connect in Thailand in quite rural contexts where teachers were having problems with bandwidth and uploading their videos. And I'm just going to show you just a very quick snippet of what they were doing. It's speeded up. They weren't really doing it this fast, but just to get you a sense of how they're looking at the video and commenting using Iris Connect. So this was an interesting project in that teachers managed to use the tool, Iris Connect, and to reflect both individually, but with mentor support and in peers, with peers. And one of the aims of the project was to move them to a professional discussion group, which is mandatory with the Thai government. They have to meet once a week, but previously hadn't been doing very much except the head of department telling everybody, you know, what the latest ministry directive was. It hadn't been particularly collaborative and co-constructed. So the question was, could video be used to create the basis for more interesting discussions? And the answer is yes, in some cases. It was a challenge, and it's quite difficult to move a culture quickly, but the early signs were very good. The last thing I want to focus on today is the idea of video and research, because obviously video, whether you're an MA student or a PhD student, becomes a useful resource which you can code, which you can transcribe, which you can check back with the participants. And this quote from Claudia Bustos, who's one of the PhD students that I work with in Chile, captures the importance for her of building stimulated recall into that process, so that the mentors, who in Chile, Mexico, and Peru, are training mentors. So it's a mentor training process. They record one of their sessions, and then the master trainer, Claudia, works with them with a stimulated recall video, or sometimes audio, to try and look at their discursive behaviours, look at how they're interacting. So I guess the whole purpose of today's talk is to encourage you to have a look at the Vilti site. It's, I think, a rich resource. It's video-based, it shows different practices. And in terms of, say, stimulated recall, there's a really nice example of Jason Anderson using stimulated recall with one of his research participants. And research is something that I think can be made richer with video, whether it's the use of VO or Iris Connect or 360, or for the analysis with MaxQDA or Transana, looking at the video extract, checking with the coding, checking with the transcript. That multiplicity, that multimodality, I think is a really exciting development that video gives us. Then there are still some challenges, of course there are, in terms of ethics, in terms of bandwidth, in terms of storage. What do we do with this stuff? Who gets access to it? But I think one of the things that struck me most strongly after this project was there's so much rich material out there which isn't being shared. A ministry will pay for a big project and then it's mothballed and nothing happens with that material. The default position shouldn't be that it's just restricted to that project. Of course we need appropriate safeguarding, but we need to try and open up some of this resource so that teachers can use it to view, to notice, for reflective tasks, get away from the chalk and talk teacher education to one that's more experiential, more co-constructed, and more reflective. So thanks for listening to me today. I'd be really interested in some of your questions and further exchanges. But a couple of key points for me. First, we need to move away from print and individual writing to a more collaborative, co-constructed form of education. We also need to think about context of constraint, which may be less favourable in terms of computers and bandwidth. And we also, above anything else, need to share our practice, to make it transparent, to make it step-by-step procedure, so that other people can say, ah, I get that, I think I could do that, I could use that tool. So hopefully some of what I've said today, some of the examples I've shown, has struck a chord with you. Thanks very much for listening, and I'd be happy to take questions. Thank you.